morning to everybody. I am Pam Trace. I'm the Executive Director of Westside Economic Alliance, and I want to welcome you to this program. I'm really excited about this. One of the key issues that we address at Westside Economic Alliance is transportation and all aspects of transportation. So to be able to pull Grace Crunican and Neil to come and do a presentation and a discussion with all of us is really a big thing for us. So we're really excited about this, and I can't thank both of you enough for being here. Along that same line, I want to thank our sponsors. WSP Parsons Brinckerhoff they are actually a relatively new member within the last year or so, and we are so fortunate to have you be so engaged with us in all aspects of the work that we do. I was at a meeting downtown with Jason Tell, and we were talking about some other issues, but we kind of got off track and talked about the breakfast forum this morning, and I looked at Jason and I said, you know, this is crazy. You need to be the moderator of this because of your history in transportation here in Oregon, and also with the information you have on both Neil and Grace, as well as the knowledge that you have. Jason is going to give us some information about WSP Parsons Brinckerhoff, and then he's going to be acting as our moderator.
Appreciate being here. This is a fantastic crowd. When I look around the room, what a powerhouse group here. As Pam said, I'm the Portland Area Manager for WSP Parsons Brinckerhoff, and many of you are probably familiar with the name Parsons Brinckerhoff. It's a company that goes back 130 years, designed the first subway system in New York, subsequently getting kind of closer to home, designed the Fremont Bridge, and just about every light rail line that's been done in the region have had some kind of involvement. Very strong tradition. And more recently, in California, we're working to bring about high-speed rail, which is a very, very exciting project, and even closer to home, the Bethany Overcrossing project that was done recently. It's a project we are really proud to work on, a great product. Last year, WSP and Parsons Brinckerhoff came together into one company, and as a result, there's now over 34,000 employees in the combined company, 500 offices in 40 countries around the world, so truly a global infrastructure consulting firm. And as I mentioned, we do a lot of different things. Bus rapid transit in Eugene and in Vancouver are projects that are underway right now, construction in Vancouver. In the case of Eugene, one of the first BRT lines in the country has been up and operating for quite some time and is expanding, and we hope it will continue to expand. Roads and bridges, I mentioned a few of those kind of projects as well, so we really provide full service. We also have experts that go back earlier in the process at the policy and funding level, including the local expertise we have, John Picari, who was the Deputy Secretary of USDOT and the person who ran the Tiger Grant program. So for those of you who are figuring out how to win that game, we have some folks that can help you out with that. He actually has built a team that helps municipalities and others seek funding through that program. So lots of smart people, just about any issue you can think of, we can probably find someone that can bring you some good expertise on that. You know, if you work long enough in an industry, you always look forward to that point where you get to introduce someone that you admire, and it's sort of an honor, right? It's a really big deal. Well, today I get double. Two people that I admire and I've worked with for many, many years who are tremendous public servants, tremendous, tremendous. We're very fortunate to have both of them here and both of them doing what they do and doing it so well. I'll start with Neil, and I think everyone has his bio in the little pamphlet in front of you, so I don't want to go through his full resume, but he's been with TriMet for nearly 25 years, and Pam, you're just full of surprises today. It's trick.
Yeah.
Neil, you must be next, so be careful. Watch what you're doing. So he's been involved in pretty much every project that's been built during that time and has had a great influence on the region. And I won't go through all the details there, but just a few things about Neil, and most of you probably know him, but if you don't know him that well, an extremely effective leader in a very difficult climate to lead these days. Very soft-spoken, but very thoughtful in what he does. He is a big believer in a strong regional approach to transportation, and he really values the partners in the region, and that includes all the public sector, but as well as businesses. And he's just done a fantastic job reaching out and is very accessible to anybody who wants to help make the region a better place. And he's been extremely effective, and I'm sure you've noticed, he got a new bridge built recently that is just a fantastic, beautiful addition to the region, and it's really a legacy that will go on for many, many generations. So very happy to have you here, Neil. Grace, who is now in San Francisco, is the general manager of BART. And prior to that, her career spanned time in Washington, D.C., working at the federal level, and as I mentioned, as the director of ODOT. And she also had time at city level of leadership, both at PBOT here locally, and then also at the Seattle City Department of Transportation. So long experience at all levels of government. And Grace is probably one of the most driven, determined forces that I know. I'm surprised she sat this long already because she doesn't sit still for very long, but she'll get a microphone soon. Grace is someone who leads in the front. She's someone that when you want to tackle a tough problem, she's the first person who's going to get up and roll up her sleeves and be out there and do it. And as a former staff person, we all were always running to keep up with her. Her younger brother, Bruce, is here. And we were chatting a little bit about that. And he said, oh, same thing for him. He's spent his whole life kind of running to keep up with her as well. So we're looking forward to hear from you. You, Grace, and what's going on in San Francisco and how that might relate to what's going on here in Portland. So with that, I'm going to transition over to this more informal setting. And Trip. I know, we've got all kinds of barriers here. So the way we're going to do this is I am going to start off by asking a few questions of our panelists here to get things going. Everyone out there, we want you involved, though. There are cards on the table. If you're shy and don't want to ask the question from the floor but want it to be read, you can fill that out. And those will be collected. And after we ask a couple questions from up here, we'll open it up. And others who aren't as shy can raise your hand and the microphone will be passed around. You'll have a chance to be part of the conversation. So with that, let's get to the first question. Much of the transit system in Portland and elsewhere is decades old now, and there's a lot of demand to expand service and transit, but the system that we have is getting old, very old in some cases. So how do you prioritize? You know, how do you approach that problem of providing additional service, but at the same time you have this system that now is showing signs of age? And maybe we'll start here.
It's an interesting question, and just to put some dynamic around the question, recall that our first light rail line was opened in 1986. So we're coming on 30 years that track has been in place and those first 26 vehicles have been running. And we'll squeeze, 40 years out of those vehicles, but they, frankly, are going to need to be replaced, and when we do, in today's dollars, that's about a $120 million bill. So amongst the things that our finance committee and our board of directors are working on is actually a long-term finance plan, and we do this in terms of really 20-year forecasts, where we begin to project what those improvements are going to be. But you know, I have to tell you that there's a lot of experience at BART right now, which is probably, 10, 15 years ahead of us in terms of that age curve, and I think it's been a real challenge for transit agencies around the country. So we do have to step up to the replacement of track and replacement of switches. We've got some very big projects coming in the next year in that regard. There'll be some unavoidable customer impact associated with that, but those are the necessary steps associated with keeping the system, as our industry calls it, in a state of good repair. So it's really important, and we're beginning to prioritize resources on it because, frankly, we don't want to fall behind on it. And at some point in time, there is this sort of point where you've got to decide about what's most important, maintaining the current system or continuing to expand. I don't think, in terms of our demands right now at TriMet, that we're at that tipping point. I think we can do both, but there are some challenges that I think you can foresee 10 or 15 years in the future.
We're not dissimilar to what Neil described. When you talk about how you make the priorities, we've invested very heavily in what we call the asset management program, and I took that from a lot of the work we did at ODOT, frankly, a long time ago. And we have quantified the 42,000 different component parts we have. It's very unsexy, and the board hates to see these presentations because they're just like... But we have educated the public, and we've educated the board, and we prioritize the need, and we started showing some life cycle curves. Where's Greg DiLoretto? Greg, it's that stuff we did, you know, back at the Road Finance Committee in 86. So we took our inventory and we turned it into numbers and facts, and we projected life cycle and we projected the risk of failure, and we prioritized every piece of the inventory. And we did that as soon as I got there, and then we started talking about what it takes to replace it. And I would just suggest to Neil, when he talks about those cars, it took my folks 2 years to write the requirements that they had to put out to bid for these cars. It took another year to put it out to bid due to all the things you have to go through. And then it'll take them 4 years before we start to see something on the track. So that's 6 years right there. And I educated people while we were doing that. But you should start my advice is start the education now. And if you're on the board, you need to plan for those investments now. 30-year-old cars is the industry average. You're supposed to replace them at 30. The cars were 40 years old when I got there. And they were behind on this because everyone wants to cut a new ribbon. I heard all those elected officials in the room. I heard you. And I understand how unsexy the stuff is we're talking about right now. But you have got to do that because our brand at BART is reliability. We have 94% on-time performance. And when you are figuring out whether you want to go on the highway or BART, BART is the more reliable thing to take, the mode to take. So people take BART. If we lose our reliability, which is where New York was in 73, it took them 3 decades to get out of the hole. Their system, they let go, and ridership went down, and fares went down, and then the condition of the system, they had no money to invest in it, and they just spiraled into this massive hole. And it took them 3 decades and a lot of different kinds of general managers who had the PR side and the finance side to get out of it. So I would really recommend you pick up that mantle now. And I'm sorry, we're going to try and figure out a way to make it snappy, but we're going out for a measure in November of 2016 for $3 billion, and there isn't one sexy thing on that list that we have to do. $3 billion, that's just my system. My system is one of about 27 in the Bay Area. I'm the regional system at BART, but we have a lot of others. So, people are stepping up to the plate down in San Francisco and making that investment.
Yeah, and I mean, this problem spans beyond San Francisco and Portland. It's really a national problem, and so that kind of leads to my next question, which has to do with funding and how to pay for whether it's expansion or taking care of the existing system. There's been a lot of success in recent years in metropolitan areas that sometimes you might expect would support a funding increase. Seattle recently, as an example, almost $1 billion approved for a wide variety of transportation improvements. But red states like Idaho statewide have been passing funding measures as well. So it doesn't just fit into one sort of, this is the only place that can pass a funding measure. So I guess maybe we'll start with Grace this time and then go to Neil. Any thoughts about what's happening that you see where you are elsewhere that might be something we need to consider and put in our playbook here in Portland as we start that process of trying to figure out how are we going to invest? And that could be transit, it could be beyond transit as well.
Let me just say Alameda County, which is one of the three major counties we serve. We also serve two others, but Alameda County, and I'm a little bit, maybe 1 to 2 million people there. Oakland has about 400,000, and so I'm guessing Alameda County has about 1 to 2 million in population. They put a measure on the ballot in 2014, and it went down by just a few points. You have to pass with 66 2/3 in these self-help counties in California. And it went down. So they went out again for the exact same measure with a slight twist on the, it's not a forever measure, they'll revisit it. And they passed an $8.4 billion investment in roads and transit. Now that's, some of that came to BART, some of it goes to the local bus system, but $8 billion, I was just stunned at the number, and that's when I thought I'll be modest at three and look good coming in with BART. And the board's, you know, still considering that. But to do our measure, just some things to put in place when you start talking about it, we've given at this point over 140 what we call better BART presentations. So staff and the board are out talking to every group like this one we would if we were, you know, if this were San Francisco. And we've gone to small and large groups and explained to them what we're doing, why we're doing it, how it's a good return on investment. And we use the asset management program as sort of our backdrop because we spend a lot of time. And the reason that asset management program is important is because it prioritizes, okay? We're not wondering what to do. It looks at what the critical elements are and what their impact is on the system. And we do trade-offs. And we're not meeting our whole need. So people can be assured that we're not, we've shown how we would meet it, but we're not out asking for more than what we can put to use. We're actually asking for a little less. That puts some pressure on us to get a good return on taxpayer dollars. And we're listening to what their questions are. We're putting in audit committees into this measure, citizen groups to oversight on the expenditure plan. And we're doing a lot on communications up front just to explain what it is, why it is. We've also tried to do some things, again, from some experience here. When I was at ODOT, we closed I-5, you know, not a popular thing at the time, but to fix in a shorter period of time the trunnion on the bridge that had to be replaced. So we shut down the tube for the first time in BART's history between San Francisco and Oakland for a three-day weekend over Labor Day and a two-day weekend in August. And we did as much rail work in those 5 days as we do in a year in terms of rail replacement. And rail replacement is a tough thing to do because you do need to shut the railroad down and get out the specific equipment. So we explained it to folks. And we also invented this thing called Rust, Dust, and Rail Tours. And we've invited local officials and citizens groups in to do a tour of the shops and just see what's there. Everyone's fascinated by a train. And when they come in, they get it. And they get the innovation of our workers. Our workers are extremely talented. They invent their own parts. We manufacture some of our own parts because these cars are 40 years old and they don't make them anymore. And so we've just kind of let them inside to see and kick the tires, so to speak, of our system. And they feel a little bit more ownership of that.
I think the question about local funding is a very important one for this group here and the rest of the region to begin to consider. Just, what was it, a week ago, the city of Seattle passed a bond measure of about $1 billion. City of Seattle, primarily for arterial, bus rapid transit, bike pedestrian improvements, and certainly some congestion reduction projects as well. The Sound Transit Board will likely be considering an investment somewhere, offering the voters a choice of an investment of somewhere around $12 to $15 billion to expand their light rail system. And my bet is that will pass because there is a level of desperation in the Seattle metropolitan area about traffic congestion and mobility that is, frankly, pales to what we even see here these days. So one of the things I think we're seeing nationally is that cities and regions are beginning to step up locally to help fund their transportation priorities. That the days of looking for an earmark out of Congress are gone. That we're seeing a relatively flat federal program. We're very grateful that both the House and the Senate have approved a bill. They now will come together in a conference committee, but we're not gonna see a gusher of money coming from that bill. We're gonna see basically flat or inflation-adjusted resources over time. So what that really means is we've got to come back to the state and local level. And one of the things, at least I'll make this observation, and it might be just a little bit controversial, but is I think the metropolitan area needs a higher level of investment than the rest of Oregon. If you're in Pendleton or Burns, the important thing is keeping that highway paved and open. When you're in metropolitan Portland, we've got much greater mobility needs because of the growth that we're seeing. Now, we are the economic engine for the state, there's no question, and those of you in Washington County know that very well. But it does require, I think, a higher level investment in metropolitan areas, in both transit and highways, and bicycle, and pedestrian infrastructure, than perhaps the rest of the state. So yes, the state has to be an incredibly important partner. But I think if I were that partner, I would really feel a lot better about my statewide investment if the local area was also stepping up to that level of investment. And by the way, these sorts of bond measures that Grace was mentioning in Alameda County, I was mentioning in Seattle and the Sound Transit area, that's not unusual. You're beginning to see this trend around the nation where cities are beginning to buy up the transit level of service that the regional agency can provide, or there are major bond measures and investments occurring at a regional level, or much greater support from the states. And again, that has been both red and blue states in terms of the trends that we're seeing around the country. So it's not a partisan issue. It is really a fundamental economic development driver. And I guess one of the things it must be a little bit on the soapbox here. But if this region is going to continue the kind of growth we've been seeing, we need to be in the same league with, yes, the Bay Area and Seattle. And we have a great legacy here. We're not as behind in our transportation infrastructure as some of the other regions. But to quote Congressman Blumenauer, who addressed our board earlier this week, Portland could very well become the museum where people come to see where modern transportation infrastructure, linkage of land use and transportation began. But don't you really want it to be the place where people come to see what's next in innovative transportation? And that's the challenge, I think, that this group and actually the leaders throughout the region, I think, really have in the next couple of years.
Great. Thank you, Bo. So I think we're ready to open it up to the floor. Do you want to ask this?
You go ahead and ask that one.
Okay, I'll do it here. Okay, so the question is, what can we learn from the problems the metro system has faced in Washington, D.C.? So what do we learn from Metro, the system in Washington, D.C.?
The metro system in D.C. Doesn't have an ongoing funding source. It relies on local government and the federal government to put money in every year. They don't have a steady, stable, reliable source of funding. And that works to their disadvantage. If you think the politics are bad, I have 9 elected board members, they represent the Bay Area. But having 2 different states and the district and the federal government as your board without an ongoing funding source means every 2 years, you know, the new governors come in or a mayor gets elected and the board changes like this. There's not stability there. So then you have, you know, different taxing philosophies that come in just in the nature of the difference between the district and Virginia. So they, I think, should put a funding source in place, number one. And so you have the payroll tax, which works well when times are booming and poorly when everything's going downhill. I think having some ongoing source of funds is part of it. The other thing the district needed to do was to take the critical elements and make the investment in the boring side. And because of the politics, they had to keep expanding and keep cutting the ribbons to keep the 4 political jurisdictions together. And so it was hard for them to do that unsexy thing I'm telling you about. You really have to work hard at it, and there's nobody gives you a ribbon for that. Not just cutting it, but nobody says thank you, because the service they have today is the service they expect tomorrow. And nobody understands the cost of doing nothing in transportation. And that's really what you're fighting against, because people are like, well, that's pretty good. Well, to keep it pretty good, you've got to keep making investments in it. You don't just let it sit there. And so that nurturing, that ongoing nurturing of what's there is tough. And it's tough, I have kind of 1 political area to do, but there, the headquarters, you know, are in Richmond and Annapolis, and it's just much rougher for them.
I would just also add, and this segues a little bit to what Grace was mentioning about asset management plans, but it was also, I think, pretty clear that while they certainly knew some things were getting old, some things were a little bit more of a surprise than they should have been, obviously, in terms of the age and the critical nature of those assets. So the industry overall, BART is a leader in this, but is moving to very, very deliberate asset management assessment and plans, and that's going to be very important and very helpful, I think, to all the systems to avoid the kind of problems and, frankly, occasional meltdowns that we've seen at WMATA. But I would also just come back and say, can you imagine Washington, D.C. without the metro system these days? It has actually built the city in a very different way and has literally millions of riders that really depend on it on a regular basis. It is this jewel in our nation's capital that has been allowed to, frankly, get relatively foggy in terms of its look. And so that's something that I think we as a nation do need to step up to. But it is a problem, I think, that is industry-wide as well. So again, the funding source I think is really key, but the other part of it, and I'll just mention another thing. In the audience was a woman I've worked with many times, Sandra Saran, who really has worked with us on issues of culture and sort of making sure people are innovative and awake at the switch and always trying to improve. That's the kind of thing we have to do in our industry as well as every other business as well, is to really make sure that our cultures are sharp and addressing problems when they see them.
Grace, you want to?
Yeah, one thing I like to say is the public gets it. You're sitting there thinking they want to focus on the bright and shiny things, but we've been out, I've been there 4 years now, and I've been talking about this for 4 years, but it's not just my little voice out there. When you talk to people, it resonates with them. They understand a roof has to be replaced. They understand that you've got to do maintenance on your house. They get it, and they get it a lot more than people think, because we've gone out and done polls, and that's why we're comfortable going out with this election. And with 66 2/3, I don't know if we're going to clear that bar. We're going to try it, but the public understands, and I think talking to them about a sensible plan and talking them about what their return on investment is, you really have to explain that part. But they get that you need to do periodic work. I don't think we should be afraid of that.
Good. Okay. I think it looks like we have a question in the back.
Yeah, there were a story in the Oregonian a number of years ago talked about the 9 or 10 different Oregons that we have in this state. And I guess concerning the transportation issues in the metropolitan area, how do we here in Portland, Washington County, Clackamas County, educate, cajole, persuade, blackmail, whatever your choice of words there, those around the remainder of the state as to the importance and the linkage between transportation here in the metropolitan region and economic development statewide? Sometimes that link is hard to make.
It's a good question, and when you're down in Salem and the halls with the 90 legislators that are going to work there, that perception of Portland and where it fits in the state is not necessarily the same as viewed from here. So it's a really good question, and I know both of you do and have spent time in that environment. So any advice, it sounds like, on how best to communicate how important this region system is to not just the region, but the whole state?
Well, I'll perhaps start. Actually, I think Grace actually probably spent more time in Salem than I have, given the ODOT role some years ago. But I would come back to the comment I made earlier, which is I think we have to lead as a metropolitan area. And if we lead as a metropolitan area, I think the state will come along. And I'll give you some examples of that. And it's always hard, but for essentially every one of our light rail projects, we've had a state investment, often lottery-backed bonds of one sort or another. But that has followed a very strong commitment from the local level to fund the local share. So it was a sort of come together and match these efforts with the local government. And I think, frankly, we need to begin to do that with our major highway congestion issues we have as well on our system. I don't think that that's a formula that should just be applied to transit investments. I think that there are major highway investments that would fit that mold as well. So again, I would kind of say sometimes it's not what you say, it's what you do. And if we as a region could step up to another level of investment in our region and then invite the state to come in and make that even better, to grow that investment, to double that investment, if you will, I think that's a much better and easier sell than, the tin cup at the door of the Capitol.
I think that's great advice. I would say I wouldn't expect Pendleton or Grants Pass or Medford to appreciate what the Portland area does for the economy. I think it's up to the Portland area to put a good deal together, a good package together, and look for partners, whether they're in Washington or in Salem. The politics in Salem are very tough, and I don't think the state should, you should expect the state to sit up and recognize your needs. You need to articulate them, but make them a business proposition. Make them an offer. If we do this, we'd like you to do this, and this is what you leverage, and you explain. One of the things we did to be successful at getting a gas tax passed, and it goes back to the 80s, and I referenced Greg DiLoretto, is we had an organization through the League of Oregon Cities and through the Association of Oregon Counties in the state, and we got together, and Greg and I traveled the state going to every county that was there and convene meetings, explaining to local elected officials and staff what the a study we'd put together meant and what it would mean to do a statewide tax. And we explained what was in it for them, not what was in it for us. And it was quite successful at learning. No one, I mean, you, I don't know if you guys remember, but you know, in 84 and 86, you know, the little berry stands along the coast were closed. There's nothing going on in the economy in the state of Oregon then outside of Portland. And the roads were in bad shape, and we went out and we made the case. I think you have to put an effort together and be ready for failure the first time around, but link arms. And then there's a higher tax here. There's a higher burden on us to in the Portland metro region to pick up some of the tab ourselves, because our projects are more expensive, more complicated, and just to do them, there's no way to divert traffic often, so you're building under traffic, which is a huge expense. It's much more expensive to do work here than it is around the state.
Great, I think we have a question over here. Miki.
Thanks, Jason. I'm Miki Blizzard. I'm co-chair of the Study Advisory Committee for Washington County's Transportation Future Studies, which is looking at a 50-year horizon, what kind of investments we should be making now to make sure our communities and our economy are vital in the next 50 years. And so I know that, Neil, you'll be talking, or your staff will be talking to the county more and making presentations as part of this study, but for the benefit of people here, that might be helpful to find out, you know, in 20 words or less, how do you see transit operating in Washington County over the next 50 years? What's your futuristic, you know, kind of prognosis? What information can you give us about what that might look like? And I'm sure Grace would have some thoughts on that as well. Thanks.
So let me start with just a couple pieces of vision. And actually, these are near-term plans that we'll be funding over the between really the next few years, is that we'll be extending the Red Line from its current terminus in downtown Beaverton out to the Fairplex complex, which will provide essentially twice the light rail service on an ongoing basis throughout the day and on the weekends through that really important employment corridor in Hillsboro, serving the Nike campus as well as and Beaverton as well as Intel and the other major employers in that area. So I think that's a major improvement. You know, where our transit system is right now most robust and frankly most developed is, if you really think about it, and you know, I think many in Washington County know this, is really between the West Hills and 82nd Avenue in Portland. And in that, what has been so successful about it, that is some really strong corridors that have been served with light rail, soon bus rapid transit, together with this grid of bus service that allows people to reach multiple destinations with no more than one transfer. Frankly, I see something similar in Washington County. I see a potential bus rapid transit on Tualatin Valley Highway, which is a really important link ultimately between Mayor Truax's city and Beaverton, and actually into Portland and the Hillsdale area. So I think that's one element. I think the other element is more local service north-south along the streets, frankly, as they are built and developed, because I think I know Washington County through the MSTAP has made some great progress on north-south streets, but that has been the lacking element, if you will, in providing more complete bus service throughout Washington County. So my own sense is that there's not a completely different package, but I do think some bus rapid transit, perhaps TV highway, perhaps Highway 26, and then this north-south grid that begins to connect the various destinations. I would note, I think Tom Mills here from our staff worked with many of you on the Westside Service Enhancement Plan. I think it's an incredibly good roadmap of how to begin to develop service. And I think it's also a model of how, and frankly, it's a model we're now replicating throughout the rest of the region, about how we work with stakeholders, the business community, employers, to really think about the transit system of the future and give us a very direct road path, at least for the next 5-10 years, and then we'll obviously be revisiting it as conditions change. The other thing I would just note, sorry, not to be a monologue here, is how dramatic the changes are in Washington County related to density and development. And if you begin to look, I mean, I still have to take double take when I ride the train past Orenco. And you've got great density there. You've got great transit-oriented customers there. And there are a number of places in Hillsboro and Washington County that fit that mold. So, I mean, the notion is that the county is changing I think, in a very transit-friendly way in many areas, and I think that's all to the good.
Okay.
I'd just like to add, I think if you're talking about the 50-year history for TriMet, I'm not talking about the rest of the transportation system. In San Francisco, we're talking about a second tube. That might carry the regional rail system that's now the Cap Corridor that connects San Jose and Sacramento with the BART system, a double-decked tube. It's a $20 billion project. We can get so far with buses on the bridge we have, but we're talking about a second tube. If you're talking about Portland's 50-year picture, I would sober up a little bit, people, and understand you got to get out there and talk about tunnels under, you need a north-south in the tunnel under the city. The streetcar can help with the circulation, but get real, 50 years from now, you should be the size of Seattle and you should have transportation that's not on the surface streets. You can't get through in a speedy fashion. We know that now. Get this crossbar underground, and that shouldn't be in the 50-year future. That should be in probably the 30-year future. Just my thoughts.
Like I said, Grace is always out in front. Push 50, we can do it in 30. So, Lou, I think you had a
question. So, Neil, we're back to the drawing board on Markham Hill Tunnel then, I guess. The question of financing and the question of, and good to see you, Grace. The question of financing and response to the voters, and you know, you quoted Seattle. I don't know what your mechanism is for the paltry $3 billion that you're looking for in compared to the, did you say $15 billion or whatever it was? Across
property,
the river?
It's property tax.
It's all property tax.
It's a bond, and it's based on property.
No local gas tax, no sales tax, all property. That is jaw-dropping, frankly. You're talking about transit, but I look to the overall voter preference, and we obviously talked a lot about Southwest Corridor, how we're going to fund $1 billion or whatever that ends up being. And I'm not intimately familiar with it. If you look at the Washington package of 10 or 15 billion or whatever it was, more than half of that was road projects. And so to the extent that we try to satisfy not just the transit need, but the auto need as well, when we put a package out, obviously you attract more voters, but then it gets top heavy because it gets so damn big. And so in the context of funding transit, you know, what is the strategy in your mind's eye? Do you do a singular, do a light rail vote like we did 15 years ago in North-South, or do you do a more comprehensive and then suffer the consequences of either not enough money to do anything well or too much money to pass at all?
Well, the first thing I would say, and Grace made this point, and I would also say, is that you got to recognize that sometimes you got to take some risk, and sometimes that results in failure. But I would also tell you, and I'll answer your question directly, but is that we have had a great history of trying, sometimes failing, but always getting to where we need to be. Sometimes the steps have to break down into smaller pieces, but we've always been able to get there. To answer your question, and I think the first thing, the answer to your question is, we've got to do a lot of research with our constituents and our voters to sort of see what the level of pain, if you will, can be tolerated associated with that. And then probably push that a little bit. But I would also say that my view, my vision of the best package is a combined transit highway package. And I'll give you an example of the kind of highway improvement I think we want to see. If we're talking about a regional transit project that the bond is, for example, funding, like the Southwest Corridor, then I think you'd also want to see some highway projects that are resonant with everybody in the region. Everybody in the region would understand that it's a problem that needs to get fixed. We've got one that I think is a very potent example right here in the metropolitan area, which is the Rose Quarter section of I-5 between I-84 and I-5. I think everybody in the region understands that's a big bottleneck, whether you're on Highway 26, I-84, I-5, or whatever. And that those kind of projects, I think, will resonate with the voters together with continued investment in the transit plan. The little bit of research we've done, and we need to do more, is that that sort of combined strategy in this region at this time is resonating with people. I can't tell you, as I circulated around many of the people here, your businesses talking about the payroll tax increase that our board approved in September, how many times I was confronted with the question, what are you going to do about congestion, Neil? And I sort of back off, say, you remember, I'm the transit guy. I offer an alternative. But I think there is a level of understanding within our region that we really do have to step up to some of these projects that, frankly, have been in our regional transportation plan for 20 or 30 years that we have made zero progress on. And I think we know what they are. They're not large in number that would resonate at a regional scale, but I think they're incredibly important to our constituents and our citizens, and I think we should step up to them as well as continuing to build an excellent high-capacity transit system.
So 1983, Tony Van Vliet and Peter Courtney try to get a sales tax passed by pledging to cap the property tax with constitutional prohibitions on it. And I was a little staffer then. I came back from Washington and helped work on that little bill. I still think it was a good idea. And having been in other states and spent 9 years in Seattle and 4 now in California, there's nothing wrong with pumping your own gas and paying a sales tax, okay? And I'm an Oregonian through and through. And so I think you have to write the tax structure, the fundamental tax structure in Oregon before you have a way to move forward much further. And I think that'll thwart us for a long time. And I would go out and talk to the voters. I'm not running for office, obviously, or I wouldn't have said that. I love this state dearly, but I just have to tell you that the basic taxing structure is not one that's conducive to our future growth, that's mindful of the citizens that can pay and the citizens that can't pay. And I think we've got the environmental piece, very high commitment here. We've got a lot of things right, but I don't think our taxing structure is set up very well. It's a very progressive taxing structure, I get that part. But I don't think it's set up fundamentally for long-term economic growth. And we want economic growth that's good for the environment, and I think we can have it within a different taxing structure. So I think there's a fundamental problem there before you start talking about additional transportation. And the only second thing I'll say is, a while back, a couple years ago, maybe it happened in Washington, maybe it happened somewhere else, but all of a sudden the gas tax became a tax and not a user fee. And you don't have to pay the gas tax if you don't use petroleum, right? And I think we need to return to the user fee concept and look at where that could take us as well. And the Oregon has done great work on the vehicle mile tax, and I think that's an excellent change. Me a vehicle mile fee, sorry. You're running for office, Lou, not me. I think you were mayor back then in 83 too, weren't you? Okay. So I've had a lot of jobs in between, Lou. What have you done? I don't know. Anyway, so I just think that it's the basic tax structure, and then to move to a vehicle user fee is something. Technology is here, okay? We've been to the moon and back. We can use technology to change that structure as well.
All right, last question.
Our last question is going to come from the other co-chair of the Westside Transportation Study and Mayor Willie.
Thank you. Just a couple of things. Neil, I'd like to know if there's been any serious thought following up on what Grace said about tunneling underneath. You and I have had this conversation. We'd love to have a little bit more of an express train from Hillsboro, maybe to the airport, maybe to Gresham. And we know we have to go through Portland to get there, and it's just too long, quite frankly. It's a two-hour trip to Gresham. So is there any plans on that? I mean, have we really seriously looked at that and just following up on that? And then the other, we talk about, Grace, you were talking about VMTs and other funding sources. You know, you say sales tax around here too often. We're going to put you on the rail that you came into town on, and that's where we're going to send you back out of here. But road tolling is something else that I think is going to become a very real discussion, although that's almost heresy as well in the West. So what are your thoughts about road tolls?
They have road tolls in both the other places, Seattle and San Francisco. You may not want the growth that those areas have. They feel very vital, and it feels like there's a future, and there's a very diverse economy in both of those regions. We're not, in either of those regions, not dependent on just one industry. So it's not a Boeing city anymore. Boeing's one of the industries. Check. There's a lot of others. And tolling is there for certain highways, and it's the same thing in California. We ought to cross the bridges. We have a fast pass. It's there. Technology can take you a long way. I want to just say one other thing, and I didn't come here to talk about the sales tax, but it's also a limit on property taxes. People are sick and tired of their property taxes here, and this is a way to reduce the property tax as well and balance the system out. That's all I'm talking about is a balance in the system. And I should have checked with Neil before I started talking about the question he just asked you about tunneling downtown, but sorry, Neil, to put you on.
Quite all right. But the answer is we really haven't seriously looked at that. There was some work that was done, I think, back in 94 when we were developing the first south-north concept plans about a tunnel that would actually have served the transit mall, 5th and 6th, or Broadway, or one of those corridors downtown. But nothing since then. But I would tell you that it is the downtown system that is... that slows that up. There's no question about that. I think one thing we have to realize that when we designed that system 30 years ago, it was a different city. And when we designed that system, it was originally one line, though there was always hope to extend it into a regional system. It was pretty well designed for one line. And it was also not designed to serve the multiple branches we now have on the light rail system. So, you know, if I had my druthers, yes, there would be some express ability through downtown, and Grace is absolutely right. The best way, the traditional way to do that, and that's, you know, for good reasons, is to go underground. Very expensive. That's why the ballot measure in Seattle right now will be presented in November will be something on the order of $13 to $15 billion, because that's what they're doing, they're tunneling. The other part of that is that we have to think about is, you know, I would love to have a little bit of the New York City subway system where I had a third track and parts of the Banfield corridor. So, for example, I could take a Red Line train and express it all the way through to Gateway, where the trip would be faster. Near-term benefit for airport riders will be the extension of the Red Line, which will at least avoid a transfer and hopefully allow people to get on in Hillsborough, get a seat, and open a really good book on the Kindle. So,
thank you, Grace and Neil, so much for your time.